Rue Git le Coeur hotel was probably the cheapest and the most dirty hotel in Paris.
It was an entire community of complete oddballs, bizarre, strange people, poets, writers, artists, musicians, pimps, prostitutes, policemen even, who had a secret mistress there, and everybody you could imagine. One was quite outside society. Once you went through the door into the hotel, you were in another world.
Harold Chapman's book of photos on the Beat Hotel is extremely important because it's not a photographic reportage from some newsman from the outside. He was himself living there in the hotel.
I found it extremely relaxing and were probably the happiest times of my life.
Harold's photos are like the ambience, the general atmosphere of the place. And the photos are very moving in that they depict this closed universe.
I was working at night in a sleazy dump in Soho, waiting on tables, etc. While I was there clearing tables, I was hearing all these amazing stories about how wonderful Paris was and that's where it's all happening, man, which was the language of the time. Now I had this idea of doing a book on Paris called My Paris. So I hitchhiked to Paris and sought out a cheap, crummy hotel. My friend called Patrick Shirley took me round to this hotel in Neuf Rue Git le Coeur. And he said, if you're doing a book on Paris, you must see this crazy hotel and come round there and I will introduce you to Mr. and Mrs. Ginsberg. So, all naive as I was, I expected to meet Mr. and Mrs. Ginsberg. But when I met them, it was Peter Orlovsky and Allen Ginsberg who were living in the hotel. I got quite friendly with Allen and Peter Orlovsky, and Allen Ginsberg used to lecture me as we walked along and had knowledge and anecdotes about practically every street, the name of the street and the hotels and everything like that. All his poetry and work was drawn from a mixture of memories and what was happening around him. It's quite a different style than one would expect normally, completely free. And that's one of the things I learned from Allen, was that you don't have to worry about the conventions of composition in photography or anything. You can just invent your own and so forth. Just do whatever you like.
It's important that such great books were published in Paris by expatriates.
The Beats had arrived in Paris just at the time of this censorship trial of Howl, the poem by Allen Ginsberg. Censorship of the English language in France was practically non-existent. The French were much more tolerant of any form of written or visual arts at that time, certainly than America or England or anywhere else in Europe.
That's why they came to Paris, you see, because there was that symbolic freedom of the mind which they sought out and found here.
Nobody cared in the slightest what they did in France. They could publish anything. Brion Gysin constructed what he called a dream machine, the only work of art to be seen with your eyes closed.
It's a very interesting device that puts you in a state of hypnotic trance.
It was a large cylinder of cardboard with slots cut in it, which was placed on a gramophone turntable with a lamp hung down in the center, which created a flicker effect, which was calculated to flicker at about 15 flickers a second. Now this is supposed to be the alpha rhythm, which is responsible for dreaming.
The dream machine is about how to obtain a liberation of the sensitivity of the free mind without using drugs. I tried the dream machine several times, and it works, you know. I ought to try it sometime.
A representative from Philips had come to see him with a view to marketing the dream machine, so he expected to make a fortune. Unfortunately, the representative tripped up in the foyer of the hotel, broke his leg, and was rushed to hospital. And that was the end of that